The railway station at Le Ciotat, a small town on the south coast of France. In the summer of 1895, on this platform, on the same spot, a Frenchman put a small mahogany box onto a tripod and recorded this scene. Caused a sensation. These unsuspecting passengers were soon to be seen all over the world by audiences enthralled by moving pictures. And the man who made that historic film was Louis Lumière. Louis was only 31 and he ran the company with his brother Auguste, making photographic materials in the town of Lyon. The name of the company was the Société Lumière. Most of the works has now been knocked down, but back in 1895, it was the scene of many of the Lumière brothers' first films. The 300 workers made millions of photographic plates each year for Still's cameras, so successfully that the factory had to expand. Making photographic equipment was a very profitable trade in those times. It certainly paid enough to buy the chateau, which was later to become the head office of the Lumières, the founding family of the cinema. Lumières were a close family, but also very different in style. Antoine the father was a bit of a bohemian, but he educated his two sons as scientists. Antoine himself was an artist both by temperament and training. He started life as a portrait painter, but like many 19th century artists, the young Antoine just couldn't compete with the camera, so he bought one himself and went on to become the leading portrait photographer in Lyon. Antoine then borrowed heavily. In 1879, he bought a factory to make photographic plates and just about bankrupted the family. He was only saved by the shrewdness of his two sons. Louis was only 16 when he started work in the company labs. The methods then being used were expensive and unreliable, but within a year, young Louis had devised a cheap and efficient way of making the best photographic plates in the world. Within 2 years, loss had been turned into profit, one large enough to justify the industrialization of the family business. The Lumières soon had the biggest photographic factory in Europe. So in 1894, the Lumières realized they had the know-how, the money, and the workforce to get into the latest development in photography, moving pictures. A method of showing moving pictures called the kinetoscope had been devised by an American, Thomas Edison, and it had just arrived in Europe. Auguste and Louis were shown a strip of Edison's film by their father, who said, "Here, this is what we ought to be doing. They're charging such an absurd price, we can do it better." So they used the factory to produce everything needed to make moving pictures, from the cameras to the raw stock. The Lumière's chief engineer, Moisson, designed this formidable machine. His task, punching tiny holes in the film strip. But the centerpiece of the strategy was a camera able to take moving pictures, built to Louis' design in Moisson's workshop. Louis was properly modest about all this innovation. "The possibility was in the air," he said years later. "All we did was to put the elements together." This was their prototype. The engineering problem was how to translate the continuous movement of a turning handle into a fast jerking movement, which would take the film frame by frame through the gate. The up and down movement was controlled by this triangular cam on a central spindle. It moved an arm up and down the picture area. Meanwhile, the in and out movement came from this segment, which pushed a pin into the perforations at the top of the stroke and then released it at the bottom. When a convention of French photographers went on a day trip, Louis turned up with his new camera. He was photographed that same day as he filmed the guest of honor, an old astronomer, Professor Janssen. Next day, Lumière was able to show his fellow professionals 10 films, including the scene of themselves arriving. It was brilliant publicity. The problem of animated photographs, Professor Janssen announced, was nearly resolved, except for a certain trepidation of the picture. Now the Lumières got to work on a series of films ready for a public launch. The most convenient location, the family's summer house at Le Ciotat. The two sons had given their father an allowance to build a house and tend his own vineyards 200 miles from Lyon, far enough away to keep him from interfering back at the factory. Here, Louis took what must be the first home movies, each scene lasting a minute, as much film as the camera could take, with the family as stars. Father Antoine kept open house and enjoyed sharing his good fortune with cronies like Monsieur Truet, an old music hall artist. He's the man dealing the cards. Meanwhile, the production model of the Lumière camera, the cinematograph, was being built by an engineer in Paris, Jules Carpentier. The Lumières kept demanding last-minute modifications, but at the same time, they were desperate for the delivery of the first batch of 25. Don't worry, Carpentier assured them, the machine is a marvel. The cinematograph was indeed compact, versatile, and surprisingly simple to operate. A wooden magazine fed film through the gate. The handle was turned at the back. The focal length of the lens was 1 inch to give the same perspective as the human eye. The Lumière film, with its round pinholes, could be threaded in seconds. And that wasn't all. The cinematograph could run raw stock through in parallel with negative film to make a new copy print. And by simply adding an arc light and changing the lens, the cinematograph camera cum printer could also become a projector. With the whole business in one box, the Lumières were now ready to go public. Workers Leaving the Factory was in the program at the Grand Café in Paris, which opened on the 28th of December 1895 when, for the first time, the public paid to see a film show. But Louis and Auguste didn't attend. They had bigger things in mind. They were going to send their cinematographs around the world ahead of any international opposition. The main rival, Edison, had a camera so big and heavy it was almost immobile. The cinematograph weighed only 10 pounds. One operator could film, process, and project. The Lumières were ready to move. The Lumières already had a worldwide network of agents selling the photographic products. Now the agents were ordered to find premises and contact local impresarios. The man sent over to impress the English was Monsieur Truet, the music hall artist. Thank you. early March 1896, Truet's London show was such a success it played the Empire Leicester Square. Next to go was Moisson the engineer, seen here with his daughter on her wedding day. In May 1896, he was sent east to make their first film of a royal occasion, the coronation of Tsar Nicholas II in the Kremlin. The Tsar immediately saw the potential of film as history and propaganda and appointed two filmmakers to record the great state occasions of Imperial Russia. The Lumières refused at first to sell their equipment, preferring to set up their own posts home and abroad. A local empresario might get the concession, but he had to use Lumière operators. The man at the end of the line is Alexander Promio, who trained the first corps of Lumière operators to be sent abroad. This film was made in a training tour organized by Promio in Egypt. As well as operators, each post got two cinematographs and could show films sent from Lyon along with any material shot locally. The deal was that local concessionaires paid the French operators' expenses and gave them a share of the box office. The Lumières got 50% of the takings and also banked 1% for the operators. The man keeping these operators in line is Promio. In May of 1896, the first of Promio's trainees set off around the world. Most were only 17 or 18-year-olds from the factory floor in Lyon, or boys recommended to the firm. A typical recruit was Felix Maeguisch. When he was hired in January, he knew nothing about photography or electricity. But by June, he was bound for New York. Maeguisch, in fact, premiered some weeks after Edison's first public screening, but he still got an ovation loud enough to alarm the American opposition. The Lumière films were of far better quality. That same year, Promio's men circled the world. But wherever they went, the same old subject seemed to attract the operators. Another train, another station, this time in Melbourne. Back in Lyon, the bosses liked the films, but the earliest film critics now began to complain about content. When the Lumières showed Melbourne races, the response was, "If you've seen one racetrack, you've seen them all." Exotic scenes were the most marketable. Promio's men were everywhere, filming in all the major cities of Europe to build up the company catalogue. When he filmed in Venice, Promio observed, "As a static camera tried to reproduce moving objects, so I thought a moving camera could portray static objects." The camera was coming to life. Thank you. Nearly 2,000 titles piled up in the Lumière catalogue, almost all of them filmed in these first hectic 18 months. But in 1897, the American rivals began to use their political muscle. William McKinley was set to become president, and his brother had a major interest in a film company. America for the Americans was the McKinley slogan, and the Lumière operators soon found the free trade in images threatened by the state. McGuish filming children playing in Central Park was stopped by police and told he needed a permit, the first time that had ever happened. Then McKinley ordered in the customs. A fault was duly found in the French import documents, and the authorities moved in and seized any cinematographs they could find. Most operators fled back to France, but McGuish headed for the border, still with his equipment and still shooting. He filmed the Niagara Falls from the Canadian side and wondered about a strange new trade. Everywhere, walls of water. The eye searches for a spot to fix its look in vain. The white mass carried it away with an onrush of furious water. Peering over the edge, McGuish got vertigo. The lens, he concluded, is more resourceful and less nervous than the eye. Russia was more hospitable to the French operators. This Russian military display was to honor a visit of the French president to the Tsar. The operators had by now been in Russia over a year, traveling around, building up a program of nearly 100 items. But the thrill was wearing off. Marius Chapuis, who was only 17, worked at the posts in Kiev and Odessa and wrote home almost every week complaining of boredom and poor wine. His father wrote back saying the good Monsieur Lumière had given the lad the opportunity of a lifetime. And by the way, hadn't he seen the film of the floods in Lyon? The grape harvest was so bad, they'd probably have to drink water, and there was plenty of that. I know, young Chapuis replied, but I've got to show the same old Russian films night after night, and I'm bored. Around this time, the Lumières changed their strategy. They now sold cameras outright to foreign concessionaires, and the trained operators became dispensable. Those who wanted to carry on filming abroad got no support in Lyon. Louis and Auguste were basically interested in science, not in turning moving pictures into a major entertainment industry. Louis the scientist set about perfecting a color process called autochrome. This, and much of his other research, demonstrate a lifelong fascination with the problems of perfecting images of reality. In 1900, Louis put up a screen 50 feet high and 60 feet wide, onto which he projected 70 millimeter film. In 1901, in a purpose-built theater, he demonstrated photorama, where projectors surrounded the audience with images. And 40 years after his breakthrough with the cinematograph, Louis enthralled the Academy with a demonstration of three-dimensional films viewed through special glasses. But nothing again ever matched the impact of those first moving pictures at the end of the 19th century. When the Russian writer Maxim Gorky saw those Lumière films, he wrote, "A wide use can be predicted for this invention because of its tremendous novelty." But how great are its results compared with the expenditure of nervous energy it requires? We're all reacting less to the natural sensations of our daily life and thirst more eagerly for new sensations. The cinematograph gives you all these, cultivating the senses on the one hand and dulling them on the other. The thirst for such strange, fantastic sensations will grow even greater, and we will increasingly be less able and less willing to grasp the everyday impressions of ordinary life. The Lumière's affection for the detail of everyday life, seen at its most loving in Louis' autochromes, gives us an intimate sense of the period and the people. The Lumières may have pioneered a revolutionary new medium, but the values portrayed in their work are traditional. Country, duty, family. "A day when I do not learn anything is a day lost," said Auguste Lumière. Lumières had sent the cinematograph around the known world. Wherever it was shown, others copied and exploited. Nowadays, whole industries work at filling our lives with manufactured images. But those first films made by a man turning a handle on a little mahogany box can still affect us with a simple beauty and offer us a visual record of another age. Another pioneer of film said of Louis Lumière, "The father of the film was true to his title. He gave us a splendid start in life, a fine education, and then he stood back and left us to get on with it." Thank you.